stalkers, forcefully ruled under their fear, disgustingly fed.
Okay, I have no clue how I got this game to work, but I got it to work. Let's go, boys. GM Construct. Let's fucking go.
The player destroys a hunter chopper and opens a sliding metal gate. After going through the gate, there's a drainage tunnel along the left side that the player can enter. After traversing through a river of toxic sludge, the tunnel opens up into a large cavern where the player meets an all-knowing Vortigaunt in front of a fire while reciting chants and coughing. Each time the player presses the inner rack key on the Vortigaunt, he remarks cryptic statements that can refer to the Black Mesa incident, Zed, the G-Man, the
Nile. We got this, but we have no flying.
Connection with the Vortigaunt, among other topics. He could say every single line of dialogue that a Vortigaunt can say in Half-Life 2 if prompted enough.
Look how we can spawn
some
them
people
there.
Speculate that the all-knowing Vortigaunt breaks the fourth wall by alluding to the player controlling Freeman with the lines.
There is. Wait, how do I get rid of it? How does one remove? Export to camera.
In the underground parking structure of the ordnance storage facility, Agent Shepard needs to take out the Black Ops team and deactivate the nuke to prevent his imminent death. Afterwards, he enters a nearby room with a view of the nuke and witnesses the G-Man reactivating it. Sealing the fate of the research facility. During the ending, the bomb explodes when Shepard is detained by the G-Man aboard the helicopter as a white flash covers the screen.
Hang-a-hang-a-der-again.
Zombies are conscious.
Oh, damn.
In the Half-Life lore, it has been implied that humans become headcrab zombies. They may be able to stay alive and retain their consciousness. The groaning that standard zombies constantly make in Half-Life 2 can be heard as the victim's muffled screams for help. This could indicate that a victim is still alive and somewhat
custom
aware of their
models. Check these out.
Ripping a head crab off of a victim shows a terrified look and a violent scream.
That huge dart. Does it work,
one
though?
Of the most infamous examples would
be oh, that's
zombie irritating. Sound effect. When this zombie moan is reversed, the sound effect becomes a creepy plea for help.
The dart doesn't work. How bouncy are you? Not bouncy. Moan. Loop 1.wav. Game board. Do you actually roll? Alright, do a kickflip. You guys ready for me to do a kickflip? Wait, hold on. My hand texture. You guys see my hand texture? It's like broken.
That was only the surface. Now we enter the waters.
You guys see my kickflip?
Child labor in the Half-Life 2
laser.
As previously mentioned in the Half-Life 2 beta leak.
I can't remove these, by the way. Once they're spawned, they're spawned for good. Sweep, huh?
Child workers would be tasked with manufacturing cremated
heads. How do
I get
like, vehicles? Like,
the head of a cut enemy that would remove corpses from the streets
parts,
by incinerating them.
Water-based, huh?
A single metro cup would be responsible for supervising the factory.
These break really.
The player could not directly interact with the children. Seeing them work from afar, either on the street or on a catwalk.
Let's try it. Okay.
The radio song. In the Half-Life 2 chapter, Citizen 1, the television screen can be found in the closet, playing a distorted song accompanied by an image of the G-Man.
Fucking stun stick. Useful stuff, huh? Useful.
The same song is also heard on the radio at the beginning of Half-Life Alyx.
Useful.
If the song is played backwards, a woman can be slightly heard saying.
Wow. Small items.
This discovery implies that the song is a poorly broadcasted message meant for either Freeman or the G-Man. What the woman's message would be is a mystery. Fun fact. The song uses two samples from the
Slam.
Library, Cuckoo Land, Ghost in the Machine. The first sample is
doesn't work.
Trumpets. And the second sample is called, Is That the Door? with a raised...
Doesn't work. Doesn't work. The thing that requires a slam doesn't work. Cool. Random crap. Huge chimney.
Free TVs. Get your free TVs. What's
the fuck?
Two test levels to be created when Valve only had a small portion of the game developed. It consisted of a test sequence designed to highlight all the new technology from the source system, along with testing the NPCs.
It'd be really nice if I could remove shit. You know what I mean? I have a giant, useless ass pillar. Just stay there for now. Counter-Strike. Yeah, all of this doesn't work. If I remember. Yeah.
Hand-to-hand combat was presented with civilians and the Metro cops fighting each other.
And we have the dark one. Oh shit, this is like darker than dark in here. Man. Warning. A different dark room. We posted.
So the resistance could use it to defeat the combine. Fans have taken this as hints or insights about the future of the Half-Life series.
It's last isn't there like a secret here? 2014, where it appears I remember the there being a secret. Hijacked and I guess there wasn't. Because I'm just fucking going insane.
Was not canon to the Half-Life storyline. These tweets were just
there's no fucking secret. There was, it would have been documented.
Okay, bear with me on this. There's this theory that G-Man is a combine advisor.
Can I? Which I'm mostly derived not good from this Reddit post,
so, think you deleted.
Okay. Oh,
Freeman's final objective in Half-Life
2 is
to kill the Nihilman, which freed the Vortigaunts and made them join a resistance
in
Half-Life 2.
Oh my god, this thing is lagging so bad.
Eli Vance, one of the leaders of the resistance,
a zombie.
Is aware of the G-Man and his capabilities. This in turn means that the resistance represents the G-Man's operations on Earth. The G-Man could have the Vortigaunts under his indirect command through the resistance. Ignored the Vortigaunts and left Zen creatures to fight against the Combine alone. But he was interested in the Vortigaunts, quite possibly about their vortescence, the massive psychic energy that the Vortigaunts share.
Is it gunship right
the G-Man could gain control of the
Vortigaunts. I'm a gunship. I'm gonna kill the fuck out of you.
In episode 1, the Vortigaunts may have caught on to the G-Man's plan and try to stop him from doing anything to Freeman or the Vortessence. Now the question is, why is the G-Man against the Combine? He seems to possess powerful psychic...
Hey look, it's, Isaac. You know, PewDiePie's friend. There he is.
Better than a Combine advisor, or Shalua Thoy. Sorry for the bad pronunciation. According to the Green Grub Twitter, the advisors were forcibly enslaved by the Combine through various like
thoughts.
Somehow the G-Man circumvented this.
I am made of bronze.
By destroying the Combine and freeing the rest of the advisors, the G-Man would be seen as a hero among them.
Hey look,
if the G-Man
wrong
the
thing.
Advisors could combine
it's corpse.
The Vortessence and their psychic
they're backwards. Hold on, they're backwards. This one, which should be this one, is this. And this one, which should be this, is that. What?
Russell was Laszlo.
Hey guys, look, I'm a thing you sight, and now I am a spooky figure.
The character accompanying him said that he was the finest mind of his generation. During the reveal trailer of Half-Life Alyx, this shot of the character was briefly shown. Character was Laszlo, especially after Half-Life Alyx was
revealed
to be a prequel to Half-Life 2.
Is there possibly
now known as Russell, who assists Alyx on her journey to rescue her father and reach the Vault. He was Laszlo during the early development of Half-Life Alyx.
Oh, NPC spawner, here we go.
Original character. The final game does include some references to Russell's old identity.
Summon Alyx,
Russell's lab,
shall we?
A notepad with the password of Laszlo. The O is a zero, can be found near a computer.
There she is, guys.
Russell is still called
that's
Laszlo
her.
In the game files.
Finally, I get to do this.
Chum Toads.
You're fucking kidding.
Chum Toads are a cut.
You're kidding.
Small
yes! Get fucked! This is what you get for making me wait through
Chum
half of this goddamn game.
Half-Life was to be the bait that the player can use to lure or distract aliens. This bait idea was used in Half-Life 2 as the Pharaoh Pod to summon Antlion allies.
Get fucked. That's what you get.
At the beginning of Half-Life 1, the player can open Freeman's locker, which contains the
Mr. Man. Mr. They call me Man. Mr. D-Man.
Artist Harry Teasley, the baby in the photo is his daughter Isabel. Series writer writer Mark Laidlaw offered the idea that this could be an infant relative of Gordon's, such as...
What's going on over there is pretty funny. Child.
There's nothing.
I know, and that's funny.
Can I put a thruster on him to make it funnier?
...as a placeholder before the voice actors recorded their lines. This can be seen in the E3 1998 demonstration of Half-Life 1, where the scientist and the security guard are voiced by Laidlaw. Here's some comparisons between the final voice lines and the voice lines that Laidlaw provided. Let's get the hell
out of here. Drink your soda!
It's not strong enough. There we go.
Cheeple. Cheeple is the low resolution citizen model used when citizens are seen from afar. Each time you see, the model is walking from one point to another.
Oh sh! He's aggressive!
Computer screens at Kleiner's lab, where the G-Man can be seen.
Oh my god, dude. The G-Man, he's aggressive.
Mossman. His face
Minge bag! Motherfucker. On. Minge bag my butt.
Eli's
I can't change
shirt.
My fucking name.
On closer inspection of Eli's shirt in Half-Life 2, the Harvard University name and logo can be seen on it. His shirt changes in episode 2. Diamond pattern shirt.
Did you just hit me? You made me quite mad!
Did I just make a girl noise? I am a female. How do I take shit off of him?
Krauseth is an incomplete Half-Life 2 enemy that's briefly shown on the conveyor belt during Freeman's second pod arrival. They appear as giant, bulky creatures with heavily modified weapons carried on their backs.
Spawn a crow.
The game file reveals that they could charge at their targets and fire the machine guns underneath their bodies. This enemy would never make another appearance in any of the other Half-Life games. Non-mechanical reproduction simulation. Half-Life 2, the Overwatch voice can say this line on the Metro Cops radio.
Eat. Eat baby.
No! I'm not eating baby!
Eat the baby.
No! I'm not eating baby!
Eat baby.
This non-mechanical reproduction simulation
that Overwatch voice could be allowing... You have made G-Man angry!
This award could also be a drug.
Eat the fucking eat the baby!
I'm G-Man mad. G-Man angry. G-Man will attack.
Horribly wrong to the point that Barney had become traumatized by the experience. There's an illusion of what happened to the cat. In Kleiner's lab, the player can interact with a small teleporter with a cactus on it. If the player teleports the cactus a few times, the teleporter breaks down, making the cactus disintegrate. The achievement, What Cat, is earned after breaking the mini teleporter. This suggests that the cat was brutally disintegrated after the teleportation.
G-Man angry! You have made G-Man angry! G-Man, man! G-Man will now kill you! G-Man!
The game wants to emphasize exploration, an intricate storyline, combat via psionic powers.
Gotta be silent.
As the design of Half-Life 1, known internally as Quiver at the time, started to take over some of Prospero's initial goals, Prospero evolved into a massively multiplayer game, which led to the goal of mixing official and user-created worlds, which then could be accessed through an in-game library, and each world
would have its own server. G-Man, man!
Baking with pure water is a great taste.
Now we're just getting deeper and deeper.
Thruster has been undone.
Real-time mod. Life 1, Gabe Newell wanted to make the environment more lively by having real-time moss growth appear on the walls if the player stays in a certain area for an extended amount of time.
Hold on, I'm trying to find, like, where's, like, is there, like, any, like,
time constraints? Newell also hinted at real-time moss growth being implemented in Half-Life 2. That did not come to fruition. Is it possible that Newell's dream of moss can happen with the technological advancements of the next Half-Life game?
Half-Life
Alyx is a zoo zombie. In the Half-Life Alyx chapter, Captivity, Alyx goes through antlion tunnel for spiders to an abandoned Russian museum.
Yes.
A headcrab zombie can be seen admiring children's drawings posted on the walls. This ties back to the point where zombies can retain some form of their consciousness. Another moment similar to this happens at the beginning of the chapter, the quarantine
zombie.
Subway map. Hallucination stuff. I'm not sure what this hallucination stuff is, so leave a comment if you guys know what this is about. Half-Life Alyx's alternate timelines.
Can I change his hands now?
Okay, so at the end of Half-Life Alyx, the G-Man offers her a favor in return for her services. Where Eli Vance gets killed by a Combine advisor. He reiterates the consequences that Alyx will face after she killed the advisor that puts her into stasis. The end credits.
Is it like a guitar?
Eli awaken in the White Force helicopter hangar. Alyx is nowhere to be seen, and Eli angrily ridicules the G-Man's consequences and state that he's going to kill him. Many fans have speculated that the ending has caused alternate timelines, one where Eli lived and one where Eli died. It's possible that right after Alyx's stasis, she will return to the vault's ruins without memories of the G-Man or killing the advisor, and progress through the timeline to Half-Life 2.
Everything else.
So, this end credits scene could possibly be a brand new timeline, or maybe
boring.
An alternate timeline, or is this timey-wimey stuff, I don't know. It's honestly kind of confusing, so, you guys can...
Motherfucker!
Can you do that in the comments? Thank you.
Can you please stay on the goddamn
Gordon's
table?
Personal Holocaust. Gordon's personal holocaust refers to a cut line...
What is that?
G-Man during Half-Life 1.
The fuck is that?
The player refused G-Man's offer.
What the fuck is that? Oh, that's a man hack. Okay. What'd you guys think I was talking about? A ghost? Oh, man. There he is. The ghost of the man hack. He's coming to kill me. You fucker can't even kill me.
Gordon's personal holocaust most likely harkens to the numerous alien deaths that Freeman caused during the Black Mesa incident. Half-Life 1 reads your CD drive. When Half-Life 1 was first released in 1998, it came out on a disc. Obviously, the game was programmed to use the music tracks on the CD. When the game came out on Steam, the music files came in the game files, but will still prioritize music from any CD you put in the disc drive, assuming you have one in your PC. Not sure why it's this deep in the iceberg, but Softman won't admit that they kept this vague to increase the creepy factor. It's all a simulation. This could be referring to the fact
where am I?
The Half-Life series is a series of videos.
Where am I? I don't know this place.
Oh. It's a simulation of
I don't know this place.
Who survives loads of violent confrontations where a random person will be decimated.
I'm here.
Maybe it's possible that the Combine invasion could be a simulation. Maybe the Black Mesa incident was a simulation. Maybe the whole Half-Life story is Freeman's dream.
I'm here.
Maybe we're in a simulation. What if this video you're watching, and me creating this video, and me reading the script to this video is a
simulation? Damn. I didn't want to be here
now
today.
Now we're past the point of no return. Now we're at the bottom. Who's playing the piano? In the vault, you can hear the piano being played in multiple areas. Sometimes it's played in reverse. You can also hear the piano right before going to Russell's lab. Now, I'm not quite sure why this entry is included in the story, because the piano could just be part of the game's soundtrack. Am I missing something here? Let me know. Fast headcrabs are normal headcrabs.
No. Not yet.
Fast headcrabs were developed for God, were supposed to replace their original
my car is still here. I still love you, baby. Let's go for a drive. FDL,
while the fast head crab is just called head crab on DL. D1 Canals 04 and D2 Coast 06. Neither of these maps exist in the final game of Half-Life 2. The game skips from D1 Canals 03 to D1 Canals 05. And from D2 Coast 05 to D2 Coast 06.
Oh fuck, he's angry.
My car is in this unknown world!
Get into the doorway.
I am fucking pissed! I'm going to kill everybody! Yeah! I'm fucking mad!
The G-Man is Val.
I swear if I see that stupid fucking monk, I'm gonna murder him! There he is, I see ya. Well, boom!
Kill him. Son of a bitch. Come on. And whenever the gate is right for you to come around,
according to quote unquote limitless potential. I killed him!
Half-Life 1 represents the limitless potential that the Half-Life series has been in innovating video games.
Freeman's Jesus Christ.
May have hit a limit.
I'm still alive.
Huh?
Wait. Is that a baby?
This theory could also apply to G-Man's decision to recruit Alex at the end, replacing Freeman as his father and G-Man's or Val's expectation.
He's such a cutie.
Gordon has no free will. It is often implied throughout the games that Freeman possesses no free will. Gordon Freeman's name and the moniker, the One Free Man, given to him by the Resistance, is meant to be ironic. It's obvious that Freeman is controlled by the player, and all the Half-Life games are linearly built with only one path to go forward. The G-Man also serves as a metaphor for Freeman's lack of free will. The G-Man heavily influences
what sleep, Freeman baby, does. Go to sleep, baby, go to sleep. Go to sleep, baby, go to sleep.
This notion about the G-Man goes back to the previous entry where G-Man represents Valve, both to guide the player's experience at all times. This lack of free will theme is also applicable to Half-Life 1.
Fuck that kid, bro.
We're at the end. Decide whether to accept the G-Man's offer or not.
Huh?
The player made was
Scamped Born! I have to try this. Scamped Born. I have to try this.
Every main entry in the Half-Life series, except for Half-Life Alyx, begins with the player riding a train. Trains are linear and move along a set path, symbolizing the G-Man's strict control over Gordon's path. Squeal 1.wave. In the Half-Life 2 beta, there is a window found in the map D1 Terminal 01. Behind it, there is a flashing room and a weird contraption making ticking sounds, almost like a clock. You can hear it make weird noises. One of them is named Squeal 1.
Oh, we can't attach
time. The only way to play this out in the final game is in the chapter Highway 17. After the player defeats their first gunship, if they decide to kill this rebel on top of the tower,
okay, please do not kill me.
It's unknown why this sound is here and how the rebel causes the sound to be played. Citadel.
Let's do some Scamped Board tracks.
Arisen about the true nature of these screens. From those
let's try a kickflip.
There is one mysterious claim, which states that these screams are a recording of the astronauts screaming during the Space Shuttle Challenger disaster, or on January
28th,
1986.
God, that hurt a lot. Huh? How do I get out of here? I have to find a way out. Now! After I lay here a little bit more.
The most likely answer is that these screams are from the process of making stalkers. Humans who have been drastically altered.
There's that son of a bitch!
Servants who mindlessly operate machinery and guard the core of the Citadel.
Mamma mia.
The Resistance can't win. Considering the sheer amount of the Combine's multi-dimensional firepower,
the fuck?
In only 7 hours.
You gay bitch!
The Resistance alone cannot defeat the Combine without significant assistance. A
Pistol 3 reflects on the distance of unreachable. Son of a bitch, I'm gonna kick his ass. If I see him again, I'm gonna fucking. I'm gonna kick him. Yeah, that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna kick him if I see him again. A hypothetical megastructure that completely encompasses a star or planet in this situation and captures a large percentage of its power output. Yeah, you. He recognizes the ineffectiveness of their rebellion. Gay bitch. Before the Vortigaunts teleported back to Earth. Although Pistol 3 is considered non-canon, that does not write off the Combine's potential to construct such a thing in the future game.
Oh yeah, you're so tough, eh?
It's possible that outside forces, such as the Vortigaunts, and possibly...
Why don't you take my powerful... Powerful... Powerful.
Where is the thruster? I've lost it.
If there's anything wrong in the video, please leave me feedback, and maybe I could do a follow-up video.
Take my powerful ass. Kick. Well, bam.
This is definitely different from what I usually do, so thanks for watching.
That's what you get, you motherfucker.
Doing less, like less busy work, less level setting, less looping.
What are you looking at? You want to take my powerful kick too, huh? No, sir. I'm just looking at you. I'm making a machinima. Shut the fuck up, bitch. Boom. Oh, you're tough, eh? Boom. 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 Roundhouse. Yeah. Yeah. Don't mess with me ever again, see? Alright, let's see. What do I do in this world? Well, I could explore that building over there.
Can I not drop these characters for like 5 minutes?
In this video, I will revisit these sections from the iceberg with new information that I found in the comments of the first iceberg video. Be sure to watch
my
the
desk.
Iceberg video. Afterward, I'll talk about some brand new entries that were not included in the previous video.
Man, I really wish my chair was here. I really like that chair.
D2 Coast 06. Many comments mention that D2 Coast 06 is the map used in Half-Life 2 Lost Coast, a cut level from Highway 17. Lost Coast was released as a tech demo to showcase the newly implemented high dynamic range rendering in the Source Engine.
I really wish my chair was here. Chapter, huh? Why do I hear a cartoon? Noise.
That I could find is this YouTube video of someone bunny hopping through the supposed map. The map appears to only be a highway road with early renditions of the landscape. Although it may be possible this map evolved into Lost Coast, this seems to be the sole piece of evidence towards the map's existence.
Citadel, I guess I could shit in it.
Plenty of comments have told me about how the Challenger disaster theory does not apply to the Citadel screams found in Half-Life 2.
No,
give me this. A particular data audio file has been speculated to have used distressed cosmonaut communications about the burning spacecraft. This will be discussed
just
later.
Just sit in the chair.
Hallucination
just,
stuff.
Just sit.
The creator of the iceberg, Sockman 1, responded to my video.
Sit in the chair.
Hallucination stuff.
Now.
Used Viscoop for the Half-Life 2 beta.
There.
The Viscoop shows an eerily distorted picture of the G-Man. There's tinted glue in the image. It appears that this Viscoop was supposed to be a part of the 2000.
My desk.
Comments mentioned how this could be referring to Hazard 01, a Half-Life 2 beta map created by series writer Mark Laidlaw.
I always hated that chair.
Similar to Half-Life's Hazard course.
I always preferred sitting on my desk because I found it funnier. Hope I don't destroy it.
Flashing all of them, tells the player to return back to where they came from and to not speak about seeing them. These effects.
Son of a bitch. Where's that chair? There you are, Mr. Chair.
These psychedelic images include the G-Man, Striders, and the Hydra. The demo ends with a close-up of the G-Man.
Now, if only I didn't forget how to sit. I bet I could figure this out.
Other comments also bring up prop hallucination, a prop entity that would disappear as soon as the player looks at it. This prop was data mined from the game Alien Swarm, among other strings and entities that could have been used in Episode 3. It's all a simulation.
I'm a shetty. Just what I needed. I'm a shetty. I'll just use my telekinesis to telekinesis it to my hand.
This text elaborates on how Freeman failed his task because he lost either mission-critical items or personnel. Screens could be interpreted as Freeman breaking the simulation, as it didn't account for the outcome of losing those items. Another comment mentions how...
I know everyone's shitty. Now if I see that motherfucking monk again, I now professionally kick his ass.
If the player accepts the G-Man's offer, the text where it states that Freeman is hired could be the simulation's initiation.
Oh no, four. At least I'm prepared. Good. Fucking, I can't pick them up.
Preparing Freeman for something much stronger. Something much more sinister than the combine.
Two behind me and two in front of me. Just the hero.
Max Derrick, who made two in-depth videos about Half-Life and his theory about the G-Man being an advisor. His
take this! Son of a bitch. Well, now, luckily, I've been blessed with powerful kicks. Yeah. Take that. Whoa, you want some too? Hey, Sonny. Yeah. What are you guys looking at, huh? Why don't you take my powerful ass? Maybe I should actually stand in front of him instead of right in front of him. Yeah. Now I'm gonna get this guy from behind. Hey, mister. Huh? Take that, motherfuckers. What else can I do? Let's see, I can fly. That can't be all. All I have to do is just no-clip out of reality. Oh shit, fuck. How do I unfreeze him? Shit. How do I unfreeze him? Shit. It's not what I wanted. I can't get him out. That could work. You just have to get him at the right time. Yes. That one. That one. Thank God. Fuck. Lucky I'm not him.
Was not responsible. timeline split? Or better yet, what if there is no other timeline? I mentioned in the previous video.
I got a message for you.
Could have had her memories wiped and awakened.
Yes, come closer.
Progress into Half-Life 2. Recently, I'm not quite sure about this idea because she was put into stasis. Well, it might have been a fake out from the G-Man. However, this mentions how the vault could have created a clone of Alice. The final room the player is in is mirrored vertically, and a clone Alice could have been created. The clone teleports up the vault through the mirrored portal on top, while real Alex enters the portal on the bottom into the G-Man. However, I'm unsure what would happen should the two Alexes meet in any future game.
At the end of the day,
Avengers Endgame situation with the two Alexes meeting each other and possibly antagonizing each other. The 19-year-old Alex could think Freeman is an enemy from being tricked in the vault and being held in stasis for possibly years. The timeline is still a mess with so many interpretations and theories of what could have happened. If I
at the end of the day, the I love this world.
Me, I'm confused as well. It seems we'll have to wait for Valve to give us the answer about what the hell happened.
I love this world.
That's all the entries that need to be.
I belong here.
Now I've gathered some new entries that I would like to.
And Gary's mod.
As you can say, I kind of made my own iceberg. Anyway, let's start going through this new list.
I think that was a good movie.
The cinematic mod is a mod.
What do you think? Was that a good movie?
Yeah, that's I actually pretty liked it. That was pretty good.
Also goes by yeah. The cinematic mod drastically alters Half-Life 2 and its episodes with cinematic effects, new music, gameplay changes, new weapons, and new.
How do you feel about that over there? I don't know.
Big Factory created the mod.
It's just weird.
Project to practice its modeling and texturing skills.
Weird.
The mod received harsh criticism from the community as they believed some of the changes were too suggestive and inappropriate for the Half-Life universe. The optional NPC models have jiggle physics and are just way too out of place for this game. Graffiti found throughout the game is replaced with suggestive images, including Russian Playboy magazine covers. In Black Mesa East, Fake Factory added Alex's room, where you can find this. I'm sure you understand the backlash some people had against this mod. Updates have ended as of now, with Fake Factory citing the criticism being the main reason for ceasing development. Half-Life Alpha. Half-Life version 0.52, or simply known as the Half-Life Alpha, is an early build of Half-Life created on September 8th, 1997.
That is not Half-Life.
The build was supposed to be given to game journalists and was made before the 1997 rework. In the rework,
I think I had a lot of fun.
Significantly revised Half-Life,